Welcome everybody, it's Nasty Poet. Welcome back to Therapy Games. Got a new video for you. This one's gonna be a good one.
I wanna end me. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
I wanted to talk about kind of the depressed individual or the anxious individuals navigating the family system with your mom, dad, brother, sister, aunts, uncles, just the day-to-day impact. So this is actually going to be for, you know, somebody with depression or anxiety or a major mental health, you know, illness, basically, dealing with this and interacting with people in the family. And I think when, you know, first things first, guys, when I'm talking about depressed, I'm not talking about somebody that's just sad. I mean, we're talking about some depression here, somebody that hates themselves, somebody that wants to die, you know, self-harm, eating disorder type symptoms, body issue images, low self-esteem, big time. And I mean, for anxiety, I'm not talking about somebody that worries about little pieces here and there. I'm talking about the person that's, you know, has deficits in life, you know, struggles, you know, individuals that can't attend school, can't go places, you know, can't be themselves because of how they feel. You know what I mean? And it's just that towering pulling down of negativity in those people. And that interaction with the family is going to be this discussion. If you guys would like something a little more gentler, I'll do a video, you know, with the gameplay and all that crap. And I'll make it a little more gentle to you. But this is going to be for the serious shit, you know, it's the dark matter stuff. So, I mean, let's start out with some of the individuals I've worked with in their course of treatments. A majority of the individuals I've worked with have attended at least some level of programs, usually IOP, PHP. A majority of the individuals I work with have spent time on inpatient or substance abuse, CD groups. Individuals basically were admitted for, you know, instability, danger to self, danger to others, severe self-harm, you know, dropping below safe weights for eating disorders. And I mean, part of the issue with that is the stress that is involved with the family. You know, every time that a kid goes inpatient or somebody goes inpatient, there's deductibles, co-pays, fees, all that stuff. Then you're talking, you know, discharge providers and all that stuff. Like, I mean, they already feel guilty about like wanting to die and failing, you know, let's just put like all the money situations on top of them, which you do have some parents that will do. You will have parents that the kid knows how much their deductible is for, you know, or their copay is for an emergency room visit. You know, tell me why a 13-year-old knows the fucking deductibles. What the fuck is this world? But, different story, different rant. Anyway, it's like we go through these levels of treatment and then the child comes out and there's expectations that everything should be okay and everything should be fine. You know, the parent is either the helicopter parent that controls the kid and doesn't let them do anything, or they're the type of parent where it's just immediately back to everything, who and what they were and what they were doing. You know, I've had kids that were released from inpatient and had no supervision, and I've had kids that were released from inpatient 3 months later asking to spend time with friends because their parents were still scared they would go do dumb shit. Listen, if you're going to do dumb shit, it's not like, oh, I'm going to do dumb shit, like I'm going to wait till I leave. You're going to do dumb shit, you're going to do dumb shit. I don't think people realize that. A majority of the times, individuals do not go to their friend's house to self-harm. They do it in their bathroom or their bedroom. And, you know, there is those times where the parent isn't home or, you know, the siblings aren't home. But shit, a majority of the kids I've worked with, they've cut with people in the house. They may even have told the parent after they've cut. And that would be nothing surprising to me if they did either or, because to be honest with you, I've seen them both. I've seen the kid that have cut and, you know, with the mom home and tell the mom, and I've seen the kid that's cut and hid it from everybody, you know, and then you look at the thing is, were they doing it to the mom? Well, all right, you know what? Fuck it. Let's talk about this right now. You have the kid that's at home, or you have an individual at home that's self-harmed, and they're the one that quickly tells their mom. You got to look at the possibilities of all the different actions. Some people will be quick to say that that person is just attention-seeking or trying to get attention from the parent. And that can be a fact, that can be true, but also in that same scenario, that kid could also just be going to the parent because of guilt and shame for doing it and not going to the parent. And then you ask the question is, well, if that's what's going on, how come the kid is not communicating to the parent ahead of time? Why is the kid not voicing these emotions? And then you work on communication skills between the child and the parent, or the individual and the parent. I say child just because I expect I don't really see that many adults self-harm that frequently, or to the point that families involve that frequently when they do. Get a lot of kids that are at least older too. They hide that stuff, and it puts you in a weird predicament because, it's a superficial cut, but what is the notification standards? What is the tolerance level? And again, these are expectations that, parents and child should have, but also providers and individuals and clients should have. Because if I have a 24-year-old that cuts one time in the past month, that's not hospitalization. Unless it's a severe cut, of course. You know what I mean? But again, I work with a higher level risk of clientele than a majority of individuals do in my private practice. Again, it's not like my average clientele is just there. So I guess I have to be a little bit more kind of understanding. I think another thing we talk about when it comes to, though, like these feelings and how we handle that, if the per individual cuts and they're trying to get the attention, let's not even say parent, but just from anybody in the house, are they having an issue with that person? Are they fighting? Was that a response to the person upsetting them? Or is this something else in the house going on and that's the trusted individual? You can have a therapist no more than a best friend sometimes when it comes to certain topics. And then on other topics, the best friend may know 1,000 times more than the therapist ever may know. And it's just a wishy-washy back and forth thing where we don't know which one's which. And I think we have to figure that out. I think the person that, self-harms and then goes and runs to tell everybody, I don't always think that I want to call that attention seeking. You know what I mean? Because I also operate under the thing that, just because somebody or somebody if I work with, if they do self-harm, I want notification and I want it as soon as possible. And I mean, maybe that's me just being grandiose or trying to micromanage shit, but part of the reason why I want to know is because we can then work about what happened and how we fix it afterwards. And I think that's a very valuable lesson to work on is how to fix things afterwards. Because if we rush into things and we try to jump the gun and stuff and just expect the person not to do it, we're going to be disappointed. Because we'll have a lot of expectations that somebody's supposed to do something they're supposed to do and they just don't. They just don't interact the right way. It's like people are supposed to get to work on time, but they don't. McDonald's is supposed to know how to make my cheeseburger, but shit, sometimes guess what? They don't. And you could say it's an accident, you could say it's this, you could say it that, but it's consistency and patterns leads to data. If I have one burger that was not made correctly, I'm probably not using it as an example, but I've had so many times that I've had probably stuff that was just shit poor made that it becomes an example. And if I was to talk about, other things, I may talk about being shortchanged on fountain sodas for people that rush them in the machines. And you have I don't know, a fifth of the cup open. It's like, yo, I'm not putting booze in my soda while I'm driving. I just wanted cheeseburgers and a Coke. You know what I mean? Is it a bad expectation to have? Sometimes? Sure? No? I don't know. But I mean, our families have expectations on us that we'll be able to do what we can do. It's like I've had individuals that start meds and immediately expected certain levels of changes the day after. Oh my God, I feel great. Bullshit, you feel great. There's very few meds you'll feel great the first day. Very few meds. Even if it is a med that's quick acting and all that stuff. The first day, you just may be adjusting. So you got to take into consideration what is it really that we're going on here? Like, are the expectations what we want, what we feel, what we want people to feel, or what we want people to know? You know what I mean? Because it's like people have their opinions about us that they don't share. And like, I would pay to live in somebody's mind for a few minutes. If I could actually be in the mind and see those little deep, dark matters in the brain that they hide from me. That would be glorious. But I think that's the areas of our brain that we don't show anybody. I have so many of those padlocked shut. I have a client I work with literally has friends in different areas with different characteristics just to meet different pieces of those little locked boxes, just so not one person has too much power. But yet some of it's leaked out. It's really well played, man. Really well played, if you really want to put it down. Because something like that was just like, imagine that you kind of micromanage your system almost to the point that you have these little cusp providers for different little pieces. But I get screwed because I get pieces of each where I have people that have huge chunks. And it's the expectations. What can I do? How can I help if I only know parts? I think another issue that we have with this stuff is like, what is the reaction? So we tell the person, we tell them what's going on in the family. What are their reactions? Who's their go-to? Who's their support? We go to them. They go to who? They go to you. They go to me. You have that codependent relationship in families where it's like when one thing happens to one person, it happens to everybody. And then their solution for their problems becomes your solution to your problems, even if they are unhealthy. You know, if, you know, I solved my problems repressing anything negative in my life, does that mean that's what's best? Probably not. Research has shown that repression is probably one of the worst things to do when it comes to expressing yourself. Well, literally, it's probably the worst thing to do for expressing yourself, but also getting better about yourself. You never know how much one incident that happened as a childhood that you take as something that bothered you, but not a big deal. Yo, that's money sometimes in therapy. That could be a money statement because that could just lead to a trickle-down effect and a chain of events that literally uncovers like 30,000 things. And I think that when we start realizing the potential that we have within us and to start using the potential we have within us, I think only then do we just hit a possibility of what we're capable of. We're scared to show that possibility though, because you know what? Family could be the one that shuts us down. Family could be the one that hinders our progress. Family could be the one that places these expectations and wants so much from us that we don't know how to give them. We don't know how to give it. The average person I work with doesn't even know how to give shit to themselves. I work with some high, I guess high, you know, whatever clients, high risk, high whatever you want to call it. But like, let me ask you an honest question. Do you really know how to give to yourself? Or do you just buy yourself superficial shit to make it feel better? Where was the last time you gave yourself love? People are scared to give themselves love nowadays. They think it's toxicity. They look from it from everybody else, but you can't love your family if you don't love yourself. So how does your family love you? I think part of the issue that we have, and listen, I was working with an individual that somebody I work with, and they were talking about an assignment they have to do for class, and it's talking about like how family impacts us and all that stuff, and like, you know, for the education system. I saw what my dad went through, and I said, "Fuck that! I'm not doing that. I'm sorry." Dad came home one day, burns on his chest from the radiator cap, like spewing out. What's that shit called? Is that antifreeze? The radiator, the stuff you put in the radiator, or antifreeze, or whatever it is, spicing that out all over his chest, man. Just like erupts on him and burned the shit out of my dad. Listen, man, I have a dark mind, and like I have some crazy thoughts. I do not want to get burned with freaking antifreeze. I don't want to get burned, period. I think that, you know, people, I could actually see somebody sitting there being like, "Ooh, I don't want to mind being burned." No, you don't want to be burned, so stop it. I look at all this stuff, man, everything I've gone through, everything I've interacted with families, whether it be my current family situation, like, you know, my childhood family, my wife and kid and my in-laws and interactions with my family as an adult, family sessions, friends, family. I look at all that shit. And you know, one of the things I can tell you about family, as great as it is, it can be as dysfunctional as ever. I've seen people that have had some excellent, excellent, excellent family members when people are around. Perfect. Like, perfect. And then I'll be honest with you, what happens when somebody acts perfect? Eventually, all the faults come out. Nothing is perfect. I always tell my clients, if you want to be perfect, be like me, because I'm a hot fucking mess and I make a lot of mistakes, but to me, that's perfect. I have a perfect balance of mistakes and success. That's perfection. 100% is not perfect. Because, if somebody's 100% compatible with you, like, and I've heard people say they're like 100% compatible with me, that's fucking scary, man. That's some serial killer stalk you type shit, chop you up in the woods, throw you in their car, and then dunk you with Haley in the river, man. That's some crazy shit. Everybody likes friction. Friction works. Conflict works. When you fight with your family, you'll take that as a skill. Like, don't fight for blood, but practice, man, because, not for nothing. You need to learn boundaries, and our families teach us boundaries, what we could do, what we could say. One of my clients used to swipe and show their family, his family member, like his sister. Like, literally flat out showed his fucking sister's Tinder swipes. And I don't know, I thought it was funny. I don't think she did, though. I don't think she would. Learn the boundaries, man. Use your family to learn boundaries. Yo, are you gonna be on Tinder if you just talk to a girl and you're taking her on a date? You're gonna be on Tinder swiping while she's at the date? Hey, yo, look at this girl's chest. Fuck that. Why would your sister want it if the girl won't want it? Expectations, man, expectations. Know your audience, know your people. Hope they know you. Hope you shared yourself with them. Hope they actually know who the fuck you are and where the fuck you're going in life. Because guess what? I didn't know. And then everybody would ask me, and I'd be mad all the time. Why the fuck they ask me? When are you gonna get married? When are you gonna have a kid? When are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? I don't fucking know. I should have just, honestly, I should have said that. Gave some bullshit excuses. Probably sounded like a fool when I was a kid. Hey, where do you see yourself in 5 years? Alive, motherfucker. That's it. Maybe dead. That's the response I get. I do that therapy technique with some of my clients, and it's like, oh, where do you see yourself? And you pick time frames. I like to do 5, 5, 5. 5 months, 5 months, 5 years, and then 5 decades. You know what I mean? So, and again, with the clients I work with, a lot of them, are in that dark hole period, that late teens to early 20 phase, man, that is a dark hole where it comes to treatment. Especially when you get the kids that are forced to be older than they are based off just what they were exposed to, maturity and all that stuff. Like, you deal with all that shit too, and that's like some crazy shit you don't want to deal with. Because you could have a 12-year-old that presents like a 17-year-old, but yo, you know what? There's expectations, but there's also a reality check. How old are they? Be careful with the 12-year-old that acts more mature than a 17-year-old. Be careful, my friends. Because that kid was exposed and learned stuff way earlier in life. And yo, honestly, I've worked with adults that act kid-like, and I worked with kids that act like adult-like. You gotta learn people to learn their roles, but also accept, like if they're a kid, they're supposed to be a kid, but do not disacknowledge the maturity level because they will fucking roast you, man. They will play you for a fool. I learned that early in my career, thank God, man. My first 3, 4 years of my career. Just because an adult acted like a child does not mean they ain't a grown adult, and just because a child acts like an adult does not mean that they are not a child. So do not get that shit twisted. Because if you do, you will be played as a therapist. You will be played as a partner. You will be played as a friend. Acknowledge the pros and cons. I watched that show Shameless and stuff. I love that show. They had the one little boy in that show. I forgot what his name, Carl or something. That dude's a badass. You know what I mean? And that kid's got, like, in that role, he's almost got, like, the mind of an antisocial personality disorder individual. I mean, that kid's got some, but he tears up. So, like, fuck that. They're splitting the antisocial route with him. Because he teared up in the episode I just watched. But, you look at that and all that stuff, his interactions, but yet he'll be naive because he's still a kid. And you compare it to the older brother, Lip, and all that stuff in the reality check. And it's like, Fiona in this one episode is where the mom comes back and she has, like, this crazy, like, bipolar, up and downs, and Shemily on the end of season two. Ups and downs, like all this hectic shit and all that stuff. And it's like Fiona, which is the oldest sister, Like, yo, she fell for it because she started being a kid again. But what should she have remembered? Gotta remember to be where we are. If you act the opposite role, if you're a kid, school and responsibility, friends, like you're a kid. I always believe that our personalities, our judgments, and all that stuff in the family change based off parenting and interaction with parenting, what we're forced to do. And then that's a perfect example. And I'm going to use Shameless again right now. Fiona was had to drop out of school to become a parent, you know, because mom crapped out. And she wasn't able to do it. So then the sister has to become the parent and all that stuff. And she takes over for like the family. She wasn't able to be a kid. Now what does she want later in life? Here's a therapist's thing right now. Here, look, you want to fix it? Who did she want later in life? She wanted to be a kid. You teach her to be the kid, but be an adult at the same time. And you double whammy that shit. We don't want to tell people that, though. That's a secret, right? We got to tell people that, you know, adults are supposed to be adults and kids are supposed to be kids. You can have both roles. Just be aware of who and what you are. Seeing a 60-year-old man do like some shit that a 7-year-old, 8-year-old does, yeah, they may get hurt. They may get hurt. Both the kid or the adult. You know, I see kids do things that adults do, and adults do things that kids do. Shit, eventually I'm gonna buy myself a VR Nintendo Labo kit. So like, if I ever start a Patreon, it's gonna be for some bullshit like that. But like, you know, adults could be kids too. I don't know. Just the whole idea of this whole family podcast, this has been irking me. It's been a very difficult podcast. It's just so many different directions to go with it, and it's just so vague. You know what I mean? And again, I don't know. I don't know if I'm overthinking it or maybe I'm underthinking it. But like, it's just a difficult situation. Putting somebody back in a house after any major treatment, any major thing, you're basically subjected to all opinions and thoughts that everybody in that house has, as well as judgments and c criticisms. You know? I heard a family member tell a kid one time that they should have fucking killed themselves better. Like, are you fucking kidding me? That's the shit I hear. You should have killed yourself better. I'm not one to shut out family members, but yo, that person was pushed far, far away from my client for a long time. Fuck that. I don't know. Imagine if we started asking, you know, like the person that this video is for. Imagine if we started asking them what the expectations of their family members would be. But I'm sad, give me space. It's not your fault. So stop asking me like it is. Say you're sorry. Jesus Christ, the expectations are just fucking mounting, aren't they? Like, just so unrealistic. This is the shit I deal with, man. Listen, anytime you do anything with somebody, it is not instantaneous. The amount of times I've done family work where I've done things for one of the children in the family and the expectations that it was all going to be done in a week, like, I'm good, man, but I'm not that good. So if you're going to do work with a family member, you're going to try to change expectations your family has on you. Like, be realistic. Like, it's gonna take some fucking time, just like you take time to get better. Maybe I was lucky. Maybe 10 years is lucky to get my shit together. I didn't have somebody like me. That's why I make these videos. I wonder what life would be like if I had a James. Sorry. I used my name. I wasn't supposed to. I wish I had a nasty poet. I wonder what my life would be different. How would my life be different? How would my parents be different? How would interactions be different? My parents were fucking good. I have stories. I have complaints. My parents were fucking good, man. That doesn't mean, though, that I didn't feel the way I do interacting. I remember being so scared to tell my parents that I was going to be a dad. Like everyone's excited for that shit. Like I had panic attacks for fucking, I don't know, 2, 3 weeks before I told them. Fucking scary, dude. Worried about judgments, worried about opinions. And guess what? They were okay. What did they? They were cool, man. They were like really fucking cool. I was also older, but they were cool. But you know, I don't always have the typical family. My family did stuff together. I see some of the kids that I work with, their families don't do shit. They don't have families. How are these expectations then relevant to them? I hate to say this, but some of the people I work with, they look at their parents' life as their life. Fuck that. I didn't get splayed with radiator fluid on my chest. I haven't been burned. I haven't broken any fingers on cars. Your parents' life is your life if you choose it to be your life. There's no predetermined roles when it comes to that. And I tell everybody I work with that you have the opportunity to change yourself and break the mold or follow the mold. Listen, you may want to be like your parents and like, fuck that, more power to you, do it. If they're good people, then do it. But I want my daughter to be better than me. I want my daughter to be more successful than me. I want her to be a better person than me. I don't care if it's a sliver better, and that's not hard to do. That's my expectations for my kid, but what's my kid's expectations that I have on her? Does she expect me to think she's going to be perfect because I try to tell her that I don't care about perfection? I care about effort. I care about what somebody puts into something. And that's how I run my practice. I expect my clients to put in a certain level of this or that. I don't think that's unrealistic either. Because you know what? I accept effort for what it is, and I accept all things. Like I'll accept the responsibility. If someone gets out of bed and they're severely depressed, fucking great job, my friend. Great fucking job. Not everyone thinks that way though, because they should have done more. They could have done more. When I was depressed, I would get out of bed every day and shower. The fuck is that gonna help? Yes, that will help cure depression. But the depressed person does not give a shit what you've done. Trust me on that one. Unless they like flat out ask you, like, how can I, like, what can you tell me that you did during your depression that will help me get better for my depression? They probably don't want to hear what the fuck you did. And if they do, like, please send me some, like, pointers, bro, because like honestly, a lot of times when it comes to depression, it's a thought or a flip or something that happens that changes things. It's not, I mean, a shower would do it, but it's the habit and the procedures of feeling good about yourself or accomplishing tasks. And for some people, that's just talking to somebody. For some people, that's getting out of bed. And if you got a person that you could build success off of getting out of bed, then the shower's nothing. You could shower every day and still be depressed. I've worked with many people that are severely depressed, but yet are so OCD that their body's probably the cleanest thing on earth. I mean, honestly, their skin has to be dealing with like some antibacterial shit, man. But like, they're depressed. They want to die. They don't want to be here. They don't want to see things. Other individuals can't even get out of bed. Can't even start their day. But when you get them out of bed, they could be probably very productive. Does that mean that their depression's not as good as the person that showers every day, or is their depression worse? Nope. Not at all. They may cope with it better, they may handle it better, but they may be 10 times more fucked up. You know what I want to tell about the kid that's like depressed? Yo, the average kid that's depressed doesn't want anyone to know. They don't. The average kid that has anxiety does not want anybody to know. The average adult with depression does not want anybody to know. The average anything. Anything. As a therapist, it was hard for me to admit my things. And I'm the one that tells people that it's the most important thing to own and understand what you are, what you have in you, because only that's the way that you conquer it and progress past it. It has nothing to do with anything else other than knowing who and what you are and what you represent. You know, a strength is a strength. You have a really dark mind, guess what? That could work for something. At least for the time being. I don't know if anyone ever realizes it, but the mind is very freaking powerful. Very powerful. What do we do with family? Some people need them, some people hate them, and some people have both feelings. Some people love them so much, but they're so toxic. Other people, they are unable to grow. Some people are nourished and literally owe their entire lives to their families. Other people, their depression may be solely relying on who and what they were around in their environment. This video is tough if you can imagine then. Because how do I make one small video to explain all the difficulties and all the complexities in a family? You know, I think if we were working on trying to resolve stuff in a family, I think the first thing we have to do is look at something called radical acceptance. And when you are radically accepting something, it's not that you validate it as good or bad, you remain non-judgmental, but you accept it for who and what it is. And if we're looking at a family member and we're trying to, you know, just radically accept them, we may understand that that family member may be great to us around people and behind our backs or behind, you know, other people's backs. They may persecute us. They may terrorize us. They may depress us. They may also put us on a pedestal that's so high we're unachievable. They also, at the same sense, may be the reason why we're unable to do anything. Or they're the only reason why we did anything. It's a crazy world when we start looking at all these components of families. And this is just a general talk. Imagine if we started going into like the interactions and all this stuff. And I ain't even including no family-based trauma. Actually, you know what? Fuck it. Let's do that for a moment. How do we interact with family members after family-centric trauma? Family can be one of the biggest causes of trauma. Be death of a family member, an illness of a parent, illness of a sibling, suicide, drug use, assaults, violence, terrorizing, sexual stuff. It could be any of it. That we trust them. How much do we trust them? How little do we trust them? And how much interactions or how much anything do we have with them? What do they know? What are they wondering? You know, I've worked with individuals who've had family trauma and come out against it, and they've received mixed reactions from their family members based off the things. I would love it if in the world that even if the kid was being naive, the parents would support the kid. But again, you gotta be realistic, and you gotta know the kid, but you also gotta know the parent. I'll tell you something. A rule that I go by is I'll never accuse somebody of not of doing something that I wouldn't do. But when it comes to certain things, like the stuff that a family can do to you, there's a whole world of things that is beyond my comprehension. And I think that's where some of this stuff and this conflict comes in, is because like the people that are there to protect us are also the ones there that can destroy us. I learned about in grad school that there's this thing called failure to thrive, where a baby will stop crying when they need to be changed, where they want affection, and when they need to eat because of unresponsive parenting. Like, what? Baby. How is that built into a baby? One of the I'm learning on hypnosis right now. One of the things it talks about is that phobias are rapid learning. And I love this theory because I think there's so much that more than phobias that we receive rapid learning from, and I really want to find a way to expand this and like start researching it. But like a phobia is caused by a rapid learning from a response situation. So it talks about that if you're in the middle of Africa and you go to a bush and there's rustling in the bush, like, and all of a sudden you go to the bush and a fucking lion jumps out at you. And like you punch in the face and like beat it up and you get away. You don't kill it because PETA would be upset and they'd flag my video, okay? So like you punch in the face and you get away, okay? And it doesn't kill you, but you're lucky, but you were scared to death. Next time you come to a bush, you hear that rustling. Did you learn your lesson? Do you proceed with caution? Or do you just nonchalantly walk up to the bush because it's a different bush? See, learning, that rapid style of learning can cause in families too. So, like in this failure to thrive thing, as I was thinking, is this baby learns rapidly that when it cries, it doesn't get shit. So it stops crying. It learned that it's an improper response. Is that the initiation of shape and heartache? Depression? I mean, that's the start of a negative interaction. Imagine just like learning to stand as a toddler and wah, 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 and ain't nobody coming because you shit yourself. I pray that if I'm an old man and shit myself, somebody comes. Couldn't imagine. Like, but if it's between me and a baby, I'll chill, man. Take care of the kid. But that's my mentality. It's not everybody's, apparently. Some of this stuff too, I don't know that we hear about like families and conflict and issues and problems and trauma and all this stuff. I don't know how much of this has just always occurred and how much of this is new. Like, are we just accessing information that we haven't known about through news, medias, and the internet that we didn't know about, and all this shit happened the entire time? But now a kid knows to call, like, Child Protective Services type stuff, like CPS or DIFES, or like whatever they are anywhere in the country, world. I know England has one, so shout out to England. But like, was all this shit going on? Yeah, when did they learn that babies will like almost learn to like not be a nuisance just to pass away? Like, what the fuck? Is this an old thing or a new thing? This is the craziness with families. You gotta watch out with families too, because like you look at the different branches of families, different interactions, like aunts, uncles, and all that stuff. You gotta watch out because you may find out that Aunt Anne, not the pretzel face, but Aunt Anne could be like, I don't know, OCD. Have an eating disorder, alcoholic, drug use, depressed, anxious, any of it. Do other people have it, or is she just the oddball? Like, she's just the one rarity. Well, Uncle Joe, not the one from Willy Wonka. He could be the one, though, that's, who knows? Schizophrenic. History of trauma. Beaten by dad. We just look at them as quirky relatives. We never listen to their stories. We never ask them their stories. Nobody, they're just, oh, da, 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 they're, she's whatever. And then as you get older, you hear the stories from family members. You pick up details from like different stories here and there. Know your family, know your role, know your interactions with people, because honestly, like, you may learn a lot more yourself. Study, learn. And listen, family interacts because, like, a family member may bring attention to something that could have been an issue for them. And that's why there's attention to it. They may have, I don't know. You may see a cousin pull somebody aside and be like, hey, chill out at college because, like, it's really easy to get caught up in a bunch of bullshit. But yet, no idea that, when they were in college, because they graduated, no big issues, they never got caught. But, they may have had a severe binge drinking disorder while they were in college to the point they were down in bottles. I see shit online where this girl just drinks fucking bottle of whatever. Like, I swear to God, I hope that video is fake because nobody should be drinking a bottle of anything like that. I don't even think a bottle of water would be healthy. Dead ass. These are the family interactions. These are the things that we need to start paying attention to. You want to know how to navigate your family is that start communicating and talking and find similarities, find connections. If you feel like your family's old-fashioned, then yo, lead the new fucking generation. I'm telling you, man, the way things are looking, I'm not surprised that if I have individuals in my family that have, some serious shit. Much more serious than mine. I would not be surprised anymore. I'd be surprised if I didn't. Be surprised if they don't. If nobody did, kind of be scared. I can't be the only one. Actually, I learned I'm never the only one. Put myself in any scenario, any situation, anything, and I realize I have at least one other person, unless there's two people in the room and we are just completely fucking different. But we made like Billie. Because on the outside, I'm not somebody that you would think would like Billie, but I do. So you really don't know. So you have to talk, you have to try, you have to put forth an effort. And it can't just be about you. You have to fake it. You have to play the game. You have to manipulate. You have to understand that, like, you want relationships with family, you have to put in effort. It's like you can't just talk about your shit with your friends because then your friends will ditch you. Nobody gives a fuck what you say. You know? I can tell my friends all the smartest shit in the world. They don't give a fuck. They think I'm an idiot. You know? I can tell people that doing A, B, C, and D will work, but doesn't mean they do it. Doesn't mean they will. Doesn't mean they have the desire to, the effort to, but doesn't mean any of it. It's like when our family tells us what we need to do, doesn't mean we listen, even if they're fucking right. You know what? I think we fight a lot with our family when they say something right. I don't know if we fight with our family when we're wrong as much when they're wrong as much as when they say something's right and we don't like it. I think that's why we get angry at them. We don't want to hear it. We don't even want to hear the truth from ourselves, let alone our family, but that's a fucking problem. More people that don't, I hate to say this, the more people that don't admit the truth to themselves, more business. Hopefully more YouTube views too. Holla. But think about it. We don't hear it from our family, so we fight with them. Do we tell it to ourselves? Is that why we hate us? Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But I think we have to be a little realistic with shit and just start, I don't know, man, admitting who we are, what we are, how we feel. Admitting what we have control over. And not being scared to talk about the moon or whatever it is that talks to us. I think that's what fears a lot of people. Every time I go out at night, I look at the stars and the moon, even if it's just for a second. And now, as an adult, I consciously make that effort to do it more than a second. I'll point it to other people and I'll tell them every time you walk out a door at night, you look up and look at a star. You don't know what the fuck is there. That could be a fucking person looking at that same star. Sun tanning with fucking 13 arms and 13 legs. And chilling there like an octopus. Chilling. Sunbathing. Drinking ink or some shit. I don't know. Instead of milk, like maybe ink from octopus. I don't know what the fuck it is. Looking at that same star, man. Put that into perspective. Put life into perspective. I wish people knew more. I wish I knew more. Like, if I was working with an individual, I wish I could read minds. I wish I could do all that stuff. I really do. Because I think that if I could do all that stuff, I'd be thousand times better than I really am. A million times, maybe. I think I'd be more successful. I was playing Overwatch last night and I met this dude from, not a dude from Canada I was playing with, and I'm talking about it. I don't have the footage or any of it, but we got into talking about what people do, directions in life and all that stuff, and asked if I could read minds, and I thought about it. I thought long and hard about that answer. It's trusted intuition about people. Is that reading minds? Is paying attention to body language and stuff, and being receptive to their emotions, though? Does that lead to mind reading? What are the steps? How do we get there? How do I do it? Was really intrigued by that question, as simple as it was. It was more along the lines of, is it possible? Any of the kids this video is directed towards, that's their belief in life. That people do know what they feel, that people do know what they think, that people do know how awkward they are, or how misplaced they are, uncertain they are, this or that, their insecurities. People do know all that stuff. This is literally the idea of it. That mind reader. But how? How? How do they know? How should they know? How could they know? How would they know? We're blind to other people's stuff, just like people are blind to ours. And when we're receptive of other people's stuff, maybe they're doing the same thing to us. Maybe they're putting on this little light side of things that they're showing everybody, this picture-perfect self, the ideal self, the real self, the bullshit self, the mask. The costume, the true Halloween costume that we wear, the day-to-day thing that we show people, the certainty that's not there sometimes. How do we take that off and show people the truth? Because we expect them to know it. I really do think that if we were able to meet minds, people would still fuck up. Because it's like the person, like a lot of people in the world can't read books. Or if people do read books, they don't process it right. They have learning disabilities that don't allow them to read the words right. They have difficulties. Maybe they have a storage issue where they don't remember long term. So how the hell are we supposed to read minds if we can barely read books? Yeah, if you read a book that's good, like, I'm sorry, like, kudos for you, but you're better than But maybe that's why I can, maybe then I'll be able to read minds because I don't read books well. But I'm gonna be dead ass honest with you. People that listen to this video that don't know me, you ain't gonna believe it, but you sit in a room with me, it almost is like I can read a mind and I can't. So if I can't, don't think that the family members can. Don't think those people can. If I can't, why can they? How can they? They should know. No, they shouldn't. Average person is stupid. Don't ever think that somebody knows more about you than you told them. And even think about what you told them and realize that they probably retained 60 to 80% of that tops. You can tell, look, the amount of people, this is hilarious, okay? And I don't do this, so I don't give a fuck, so I'm gonna talk about it. The amount of people that use their birthday as their fucking passwords is pathetic. It's pathetic how many people do that. And anybody that's doing that, do not dislike this because you use it. Like, there's no hate here. But, like, the reality is the average person doesn't remember somebody's birthday. It's safe. We have to teach my daughter our phone numbers, my cell phone number, my wife's cell phone number, because guess what? No kid dials it anymore. Right now, in order to use a cell phone, do you know what you do? You push the contact, you ask Google or Siri, call mom, call dad, call aunt, call Mimi. Call Gaga. There's no da-da-da-da-da-da-da. There is none of it. So we expect them to know this stuff? Stop being naive. Don't expect people to know stuff either that you don't admit to your damn self. Because I'll tell you something, like, until you admit it to yourself, you're not going to admit it to me. And until you admit it to me, you're definitely not going to admit it to your family. And if you don't have a me, find a me. There's plenty of bees out there. Maybe not as good as me, but there's plenty of bees. Probably not as good as me. But whatever. That's a whole different scenario because you'd be listening to their video, not mine. Suckas. But you gotta start admitting it to yourself. You gotta start being real. Accept. Radically accept the things about ourselves we like and dislike. My racing thoughts in therapy make me productive. If you know how to use them. Somebody with really great manipulation skills can stop a lot of people from wanting to kill themselves if they use it right. So, like, admit your faults. Admit your thing. Admit your shit, man. For once, admit your shit. Own it. Author it. Sell it to people. Let them know who and what you are. Let them know who and what you stand for. Listen, do you want to know how to change expectations in the family? Really fucking simple. It's on you. You do different. Whether it's for you or for them, I don't. I honestly prefer it for you, but it better be the right thing for you because yeah, I could think of the clients. I could think of three people on the top of my head right now that would literally say, "Oh, the family wants me dead. I'll kill myself then." Because no. Don't play that bullshit. But, you know, be realistic. You know? Not killing yourself and dealing with it every day and not attempting and doing the things that you're supposed to do, but having the thoughts, that is a fucking great job. Deserves a fucking award. Expectations versus reality and radical acceptance. I accept the fact that I'm going to live. It doesn't mean I don't want to die, but I'll choose to live. So don't freak out because I'm choosing to live. So don't freak out if I think I want to die. People will. People will, my friends. I want to leave you guys with one final note. Yeah, you make it. Y'all are the ones that make what you want to make out of this. If you have expectations by a family and it's realistic or unrealistic, it's up to you to discuss it. Because if you're going to allow other people to make decisions for yourself, then understand that you're limited to their perspective, their views, their beliefs, their past, their culture. And just because somebody did this and it worked does not mean it is a proper solution. The reality is, this could be a really piss poor solution. You know what they used to put cocaine in cola. They used to serve like heroin is like I think like a cough syrup or something or a cough suppressant. GHB used to be sold at GNC. Does that make it right? All right, everybody. Let me know if you guys want anything specific. I love making these videos. You'll follow my shit. I got it up on the screen. I Instagram DM'd Billie Eilish before I did this. I gave a couple days. I got no response, but I'm not monetizing it, so I don't foresee myself getting fucks. But yo, shout out to Billie for making the song. It's a dope ass song. I'm gonna listen to it after this just to de-stress. Yeah, if you got any suggestions for future videos, let me know. do all that shit on the bottom, like stars, bells, happy comments, whatever's clever. As you can see, I'm trying to do some stuff for the goal for maybe either the next video or the video after that. I would love to put something over the background going, maybe some swirlies or something cool. I love space, so like it'd be cool if I have a slideshow of some space gifs or some shit like that, or gifs or whatever the fuck they're called. Who knows what's gonna happen, man? But I'm gonna keep expanding this shit. And again, the goal's weekly. I just hope I don't run out of topics. But it is what it is, man. And if I do, then fucking, you guys really gotta submit. All right, everybody. Thanks. I appreciate it, man. The fact that I set a goal for this channel to have 50 total videos views, and I've blown that shit out of the water is just amazing. So just keep watching, man. Like, you know, I'm not changing my goal. My next goal is still the podcast, but you know, I don't want to stop putting out content because I don't want to pay for RSS and I don't want to put out one video a month for free and then have what? Three ideas just mixed here. I don't want to split my shit. So until I figure all that piece out, guys, this is gonna be the home. I do have my messy channel. Once I get messy up and going, we'll see how that works. But I don't like recording right onto there, because I really kind of like OBS. So maybe I'll find a way just to stream this on. Oh, maybe I could just stream this onto messy then. Alrighty, guys. Again, thanks everybody for listening. I really appreciate y'all. One love.